Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the CC EduSet live lecture. Dear friends, this is the third lecture on phase equilibria, and today also we are going to understand more and more in the series. So we would like to tell you all that for this very discussion today, we have once again with us in our studios Dr. Amit Kumar. Dr. Amit Kumar is Senior Assistant Professor in Department of Chemistry, the Al Singh College, University of Delhi. Dr. Amit Kumar has immense experience and he is continuously contributing so that students could get in-depth knowledge. So let's welcome our guest Dr. Amit Kumar, and let's try to get through him the immense experience, the immense knowledge which he is carrying. Hello sir, welcome to the EduSet lecture.
Thank you Githika, thank you very much. First of all, I wish very good afternoon to all my dear viewers. Dear viewers, as you have already been apprised of that this is third lecture in the series Phase Equilibria, where we have covered a number of topics, such as we have discussed the what is actually the concept of phase. We have also discussed what is a phase rule and what importance the phase rule owes for the purpose of phase equilibria studies, and we had derived phase rule for non-reactive system also, and there we highlighted upon that we have a term called constituents and another term called independent constituents, and we also tried to clarify what is the difference between constituent and independent constituents or the components a little bit. But now in this lecture we start with that actual discussion of phase of the phase rule for a reactive system, and thereby we would like to see what way the phase rule equation for a reactive system is different from phase rule equation of a non-reactive system, and thereby once we develop the phase rule equation for reactive system, that will also help us to clarify actually the difference between a constituent and a component. A component which is also called as independent constituents which are present in the system. So that will also help us to clarify a lot more about what is actually the component or independent constituents. That would be clarified in the light of phase rule equation for a reactive system. So, in this session, we will begin with the derivation of phase rule for a reactive system. Thereby, the discussion will be devoted to the understanding of the concept of a component or independent constituent of a system, and following which we will take up several examples to determine in the practical situations how we can look for how many components a particular system has. So, all those discussion devoted to the discussion of examples will help us to know how we can identify the number of components in a given system, provided it's all the number of constituents are given. Following which, the another important aspect of the today's discussion will be devoted to the derivation of Clapeyron equation and what actually Clapeyron equation does for us, and this is an equation which is, you can say, is the foundation for discussion of phase diagrams. So we would like to see what way it helps us to actually understand the phase diagrams and what way the phase diagrams can actually help us to look for practical applications in the physical world. So we start with our discussion first of all with the derivation of phase rule for a reactive system. So let us consider phase rule for reactive system, and for that let us first of all consider a system in its equilibrium state. Again, as we have considered for a non-reactive system, here also we will consider a system which in its equilibrium state has, let us say, p number of phases. So p is a number, you can say p is a variable which can be assigned some number, and that will help us to know how many phases are present in the system. And suppose in the system there are C constituents, that is C is the number of chemical species which are present in the system. All of them are called constituents. Having said this, we further make some assumptions, and the assumption is chemical reaction occurs in the system. Earlier we had assumed that there is no chemical reaction which occurs between the constituent systems. Now let us say that yes, there occurs some chemical reactions in the system. And moreover, another assumption is that each chemical species is present in each and every phase. With this, as we had tried to derive phase rule for a non-reactive system, here also we will start with determination of how many kind and types and their exact number of variables whose values we are required to give their values in order to describe the system completely, in order to describe the intensive state of the system completely. So temperature is one such intensive variable, which in the equilibrium state in the system all the phases will have same value, and similarly therefore we just have only one variable, the temperature, and similarly we have there is one variable called pressure, that is the pressure of the system will be applicable as pressure on each and every phase present in the system. So having said this, then thereafter there are composition terms. Composition terms means intensive composition terms, and you all know from in the knowledge you have gained from the previous lecture that intensive composition terms are nothing but amount fractions of various chemical species which are present in different phases. As we have assumed that in each phase there are chemical constituents, all the chemical constituents are present in each and every phase. So there are C constituents which are present in P each of which is present in P number of phases. So we multiply the value of P and C together, that is PC therefore is the number of amount fraction terms whose values we are required to specify as the composition terms in all the phases which are present in the system. Alright, so if we sum, there are no other variables because temperature, pressure and composition, these are the only intensive variables whose values we are required to specify. So we can make a sum of these, it comes to PC plus 2, the number of variables which we are required to specify in total, right. Having said this, now we have identified how many variables which we are required to specify. Now the question is, how many equations between these variables are available so that we can solve for them and so that we can determine how many variables are independent variables and whose values we are required to specify. So in order to do that, we need to identify first of all the number of equations available. So let us see, again the first types of equation is that the sum of amount fractions of all the chemical species which are present in a particular phase, their sum should be equal to 1. So if we consider there is phase number 1, in phase number 1 there are C constituents which are present. So amount fraction of component 1 in phase 1, it is this first variable, plus amount fraction of component 2 in phase 1, plus so on and so forth up to k, and you have to add all these terms till amount fraction of component C in phase 1, the sum of all these should be equal to 1. So for phase 1 there is one equation, similarly for phase 2 there is one equation, which is second equation, and so on so forth up to pth equation. Therefore you get is p equal number of equations for the first types of equations, that is the sum of amount fractions in each phase must be equal to 1. This is the type of equation, and this type of equation there are p in number total, the equal to the number of phases, right. After having said this, let us identify the second type of equation, that is the thermodynamic condition of phase equilibria. As we all know, thermodynamic condition for phase equilibria is that the value of amount, the value of chemical potential or of each and every constituent in present in different phases should be same. That is, chemical potential component 1 in phase 1 should be equal to chemical potential of component 1 in phase 2 and phase 3 up to pth phase. So, therefore, there are for first constituent, since first constituent is present in all p phases, you have p minus 1 equal to signs, it means p minus 1 number of equations. Similarly, since second constituent, all the constituents are present in all the phases, so you will have C times p minus 1 number of equations, because for each constituent there are p minus 1 equations of the type and there are C constituents. So, C into p minus 1 number of equations, which are of thermodynamic conditions of phase equilibria, that is chemical potential of each constituent will have the same value in all the phases. So, this type of equations, their number we have also got, that is C into p minus 1. Now, if the react till the point of time, till the system is non-reactive, we had only up to these many equations. Now, let us consider if the reaction system is reactive in nature, that is whatever the chemical constituents which are present in the system, they could react and form certain other chemical species. In that situation, we will have some reactions. So, for as an example, we can consider that, let us consider an equilibrium chemical reaction of the type that some constituent A and B together go to react to form constituent C and D. And so, therefore, for each of these type of equilibrium chemical reaction which occurs in the system, which are independent in nature, there is an equilibrium reaction equilibrium condition. For each equilibrium reaction equilibrium, you have one equilibrium reaction equilibrium condition, that is sum of stoichiometric times the stoichiometric means nu I, the stoichiometric coefficient of component I, mu I is chemical potential of component I. So, the condition for reaction equilibrium chemical reaction is that stoichiometric coefficient times the chemical potential of each and every chemical species when summed over, it results to 0. That is, because stoichiometric coefficient of the reactants would be given negative sign and stoichiometric coefficient of product species would be given positive sign. As you all know this from the chemical equilibrium chapter which you would have studied in semester 2 of CBCS course. So, therefore, this is the criteria for every such independent chemical equilibrium reaction, there occurs a reaction equilibrium condition of the type sum nu I mu I equal to 0, that is sum of stoichiometric coefficient times the chemical potential of each and every chemical constituent is equal to 0. Here we will take only those constituents which do participate in that particular chemical reaction. It is important to note, this point is very important. So, the number of such independent chemical reactions will be there, that many reaction equilibrium conditions will also be there. So, what it does mean? If you have one reaction in the reaction system, then you have one such equilibrium reaction equilibrium condition which involve chemical potentials of the participating chemical constituents present in the system. So, if there is one equilibrium chemical reaction, there is one equilibrium reaction equilibrium condition in terms of chemical potential of participating chemical constituents. If there are, let us say, R number of such independent reactions which occurs in the system, in that situation, you will have R such reaction equilibrium conditions which are available, or in terms or in other words, we can say that R number of equations which will be available for us to solve for and to look for the intensive composition terms be solved in terms of these such equations. Having said this, despite in addition to number of reactions which occurs in the system, there are certain other additional satisfying conditions also which occurs in the system. These are the additional satisfying conditions which occur in terms of in terms of the stoichiometric equality between stoichiometric coefficients of certain chemical species which do participate in the system, or it would also occur in the case of in the situation of ionic systems where some ionic chemical species are involved. It may also come in terms of electroneutrality condition. We will shortly see what this additional satisfying condition do actually means by taking some examples. So, let us discuss that. But before that, we would say if there are Z is the number of such independent chemical independent additional satisfying conditions, then Z will be considered again as equations, because Z will be the number of such further equations which are available which we can solve for, and we can determine the values of various intensive parameters or variables. So, we should also, in addition to R, the number of reactions which do occur in the system, in addition to that we should also subtract the additional satisfying conditions, the number of additional satisfying conditions which is designated by symbol Z over here. So, we can take one example over here, and from this example we can come to little more clarity what actually is the equation which results in terms of additional satisfying conditions. So, let us consider an example where we have taken a system. In the system we have gaseous ammonia, and when that gaseous ammonia is decomposed, it leads to, if suppose there is 2 mole of ammonia, for decomposition of every 2 mole of ammonia there occurs formation of 1 mole of nitrogen and 3 mole of hydrogen. This is what the stoichiometry tells us. So, let us further make an assumption over here in this example, that let us suppose that we do not introduce any nitrogen or any hydrogen in the system by virtue of addition of these chemical species in the system, but instead these chemical species, therefore nitrogen and hydrogen, comes in the system only because of decomposition of ammonia in the system. And when it is so, now for, as we all know, that there is, it means one chemical equilibrium chemical reaction occurs in the system. So, if you have added ammonia in the system, but because of decomposition reaction which occurs in a way that a chemical equilibrium reaction is established between ammonia, nitrogen and hydrogen. So, total number of constituents will now in the system be 3. One is ammonia, one is nitrogen and the other is hydrogen. So, 3 constituents will be there, and because 3 constituents will be there, and we may now consider that we have not added any nitrogen and hydrogen in the system, but any nitrogen and hydrogen, if it is present in the system just because of decomposition of ammonia and just because of the fact that there is established an equilibrium between ammonia, nitrogen and hydrogen as the participating chemical species in the equilibrium chemical reaction. Now, if it is so, then therefore, let us say, suppose for every 2 mole of ammonia which when undergo decomposition, it lead to formation of 1 mole of nitrogen and 3 mole of hydrogen. So, it means if there is n number of moles of nitrogen, then there will be 3 times the number of mole of hydrogen will be 3 times the number of moles of nitrogen. Please have a look at it from illustration, mathematical equation, we can understand it little bit more clearly and carefully. So, since as we can see, stoichiometric coefficients in a balanced chemical equation for this ammonia decomposition reaction suggest us that for every 2 mole of ammonia being decomposed, there is 1 mole of nitrogen is produced and 3 mole of hydrogen is produced. So, product species would be 4 mole, out of which 1 mole will be nitrogen and 3 mole will be hydrogen. So, number of mole of hydrogen will be equal to 3 times the number of mole of nitrogen. That is what is written. Number of moles of hydrogen is equal to 3 times the number of moles of nitrogen. So we have established a mathematical equation here that says that number of moles of hydrogen is equal to 3 times 3 into number of moles of nitrogen. Now, if we divide this equation by total number of moles, then what we get is amount fraction of hydrogen is equal to 3 times amount fraction of nitrogen. So, we have established a stoichiometry by virtue of a relationship between stoichiometry between these two product chemical species, that is nitrogen and hydrogen, which occurs, which both of them which occur only in one single phase. So, we can establish such an equation between those product chemical species which are in the same phase. So, therefore, we have got one equation over here, and from this equation we get this is an additional satisfying condition. So, for this system we have one equilibrium chemical reaction, that is ammonia is in equilibrium with nitrogen and hydrogen, and therefore, R is equal to 1, only one reaction occurs. And in addition, we have one additional satisfying condition that says according to stoichiometry, the chemical species being present in same phase, that is nitrogen and hydrogen, and which says that amount fraction of hydrogen is equal to 3 times the amount fraction of nitrogen. So, therefore, what we get is an additional satisfying condition. Similarly, we can consider an ionic solution. In ionic solution, suppose for example, we prepare a solution of sodium chloride in water. So, when we prepare a solution of sodium chloride in water, we all know sodium chloride gets ionized in water and leads to aqueous sodium ions, aqueous chloride ions along with water which is present in the liquid phase. So, when an unsaturated solution of sodium chloride is present in the system, it means we have three chemical constituents, one sodium ions, one chloride ion and one water. So, three sodium ion, chloride ion and water, these are three chemical species which are present. So, number of constituents being present in the system is 3. But we all know when we have dissolved 1 mole of sodium chloride in water, it means it will lead to formation of 1 mole of sodium ion and 1 mole of chloride ion, and both these ions are present in same phase. So, there is a direct relationship between their intensive compositions of sodium ion and chloride ion. What it says, number of mole of sodium ion in liquid phase equal to number of mole of chloride ion in liquid phase. When we divide by, because their number of moles are same, when we divide by the total number of moles of all the chemical species present in the system, then it leads to the an equation that is amount fraction of sodium ions is equal to amount fraction of chloride ions being present in the system. So, in this way we get another additional satisfying conditions for an aqueous solution of an ionic salt species, that is sodium chloride. So, we have we have three chemical constituents being present, and so therefore, this is one additional satisfying conditions, this X. So, now we would say we further once again return back to the discussion of the number of equations. We have seen earlier that the sum of amount fraction terms in each phase, this type must be equal to 1, this type of equations there are p in number, and thermodynamic condition of phase equilibria there are C into P minus 1, that is the number, and number of equilibrium chemical reactions, if there are suppose R number of equilibrium chemical reactions which are independent, they occur in the system, then there is another, therefore, R such equations are also available. And if number of additional satisfying conditions as we have discussed for the decomposition of ammonia just yet, it means if there are Z number of such additional satisfying conditions, then there are Z number of such equations are further available. So, now what we have total number of equations as P plus C into P minus 1 plus R plus Z. So, we get is total number of equations. Now, the variance or degree of freedom, what is spread? That is what the phase rule predicts, that freedom, that degree of freedom is equal to total number of intensive variables minus total number of equations available, which relate these intensive variables. And we have come to know already that total number of intensive variables are PC plus 2, from which we can subtract total number of equation available, that is P plus C into P minus 1 plus R plus Z. So, what you can see over here, what we get is, we can expand this algebraic equation, what we get is PC plus 2 minus in bracket P plus PC minus C plus R plus Z. What we do is, we take the algebraic equation P plus PC minus C plus R plus Z, outside of bracket the sign gets changed of all the algebraic terms, and therefore we get here in this equation the degree of freedom equal to PC plus 2 minus P minus CP plus C minus R minus Z. PC cancels with CP, what you get is F equal to C minus R minus Z minus P plus 2. Now, it is very important to note for all of you to make note of this point. Over here, this phase rule equation for reactive system is just same as that of phase rule equation for a non-reactive system, except for the fact that here two more terms, the number of reactions and number of additional satisfying conditions which occurs, they also get subtracted from C, the number of constituents. And this bracket equation, that is C minus R minus Z, is equal to C I and D, C subscript I and D, or in other words C int. C int is nothing but independent number of independent chemical constituents. In terms of number of reactions, you can see there are R number of additional equations available, Z is again additional satisfying conditions if are available. So, the number of constituents which are present with us, from that number we can subtract these many equations which are available. So, we need to specify the composition, or in other words the amount fraction of only those chemical constituents which are independent. Means if we vary their proportion or amount fractions, this variation would not disturb the equilibrium situation of the system. All others gets automatically fixed. So, anyway, so chemical this independent number of chemical constituents C ind is also called as number of components present in the system. So, you can see over here the only difference between a reactive and a non-reactive system is, for a non-reactive system you have F equal to C minus P plus 2, and so long as there is no reaction occurs in the system, so long as there is no additional satisfying condition being present in the system, in that situation F equal to C minus P plus 2, where C is the number of constituents and is also the number of components, because all of them are independent, they do not react among each other, there is no stoichiometric equation available between the constituents present. So, all those constituents are independent, so their amount fraction terms would also be independent. Over here, when you consider the phase rule for a reactive system, here F is equal to C I and D, C ind minus P plus 2, where C ind or C I and D is nothing but independent number of chemical constituents, and they are also called as the number of components present in the system. So, one thing should be very clear from this discussion is that the number of chemical species which are present in the system, they are called as constituents of the system. If there is no reaction occurs, no additional satisfying condition occurs, then the amount fractions of all these chemical constituents which are present in the system, they are all independent. All of the value of all of these amount fraction terms you are required to specify, and so therefore you will say that all the constituents are the components. Therefore, component is nothing but all the chemical constituents which are independent in nature, whose amount fraction values you are required to specify. But now, when you consider a reactive system, then the number of constituents which are present in the system is greater. Because in terms of number of reactions and in terms of additional satisfying conditions, there are equations which are available. The number of such equations you can subtract from number of constituents. What you get is the remaining number of constituents which are now independent. Now there is no relationship between the remaining between the amount fractions of remaining constituent in the system, and so therefore these remaining constituents which are independent in nature, they are called components. So with this discussion, I do believe that the concept of component and constituents and the distinction between the two terms should be very clear. And this distinction would also be made little bit more clear by taking several more examples, several other examples. So similarly, for example, over here itself, we can consider the same example, that is of decomposition of ammonia. What we had discussed there is that if we have ammonia being present in the system, then it undergo decomposition to form nitrogen and hydrogen. And the stoichiometry suggests us that when 2 moles of ammonia gets decomposed, it leads to formation of 1 mole of nitrogen and 3 mole of hydrogen. So therefore, one is the condition for reaction equilibrium, that is 2, the stoichiometry coefficient of ammonia times the chemical potential of ammonia is equal to 1, the stoichiometry coefficient of nitrogen, and 3 times the chemical potential of hydrogen. So that is what we will discuss in this coming session. Thank you so much. Dear viewers, as you are aware that in our previous module we had discussed what is the difference between a constituent and a component of a system. Now in this session we are going to take up the same aspect, that is the differentiation between constituent and component, by taking several examples. As we had taken there also, we will start with same example, that is of a decomposition of ammonia. Suppose in a system we have ammonia being filled in it, and we carry out its thermal decomposition. So an equilibrium is established between the products, chemical species which result from decomposition, that is nitrogen and hydrogen, and the ammonia, which is of course a reactant. So now when such an equilibrium is established, we all know for decomposition of every 2 mole of ammonia, there it leads to formation of 1 mole of nitrogen and 3 mole of hydrogen. So let us see what way we can determine the number of components over here. Although in the system we have added only ammonia, but since because of its decomposition it has led to formation of nitrogen and hydrogen, so we have all the three species in equilibrium. So we have number of constituents C is equal to 3. Right. Now, the question arises, what is CIND or CIND or independent number of constituents out of all these three? Or in other words, what is the number of components present in the system? Is the number of component different from number of constituent or it is not? Simple answer to this question is, if the participating chemical constituents which are present in the system, they are in equilibrium by way of a chemical reaction, that is, an equilibrium chemical reaction is established, independent chemical reaction is established, even just one, then the number of components will be less than the number of constituents which are present. It is a simple thumb rule. If there is no reaction occurs in the system, even then, if there is some additional satisfying condition which is present in the system, even then the number of components will be less than the number of constituents present in the system. So, with this same example, the decomposition of ammonia which I have just listed, with this example, let us see what way the discussion, what way we can predict the number of components, how we can determine. So, just have a look. So, we can consider decomposition of ammonia here in evacuated system. Here we all know this is an equilibrium chemical reaction. So we have an equation in terms of reaction equilibrium condition that says sum of stoichiometric coefficient times the chemical potential of all the participating chemical species be equal to 0. If products are taken to right side and reactants are taken to left side, we get this equation, that is 2 times the chemical potential of ammonia is equal to 1, that is stoichiometric coefficient of nitrogen, times chemical potential of nitrogen plus 3, that is stoichiometric coefficient of hydrogen, times chemical potential of hydrogen. So, we may consider that while making up the system, we do not introduce nitrogen and hydrogen in the system by ourselves. So, in that situation we get an additional satisfying condition, that is, for every 1 mole nitrogen we have 3 mole hydrogen. So, what it does mean, the number of moles of hydrogen is equal to 3 times number of mole of nitrogen, because there is 1 mole of nitrogen and 3 mole of hydrogen. So, you need to multiply 3 with number of mole of nitrogen in order to get the equation. So, this is what the equation is. Now, when you divide this equation by total number of moles of all the chemical species present, what in that phase, what you get is x amount fraction of hydrogen equal to 3 times amount fraction of nitrogen. So, this is an additional satisfying condition. So, now let us see, there are 3 chemical constituents present in the system, that is ammonia, nitrogen and hydrogen, 3. So, 3. Number of reactions, there is only one reaction which occurs between these 3. So, R is equal to 1. So, number of additional satisfying condition, that is, by virtue of stoichiometry, by virtue of presence of nitrogen and hydrogen in same phase, they have a stoichiometric relationship between the two, that says amount fraction of hydrogen is equal to 3 times amount fraction of nitrogen. So, additional satisfying condition Z is 1, additional satisfying condition. So, what you get, CIND from phase rule of reactive system, CIND, independent number of chemical constituents or components is equal to C, number of constituents present in the system, minus R minus Z. So, number of constituent 3 minus R 1 chemical reaction minus 1 minus Z 1 additional satisfying condition. So, here also you will subtract 1. So, what you get, 3 minus 1 minus 1 equal to 1, out of 3 chemical constituents which are present in the system, there is only 1 which is present as independent chemical constituent. So, number of component is just 1. Here for this type of example. Now, the same system you can see is very important. Number of constituent is the number of chemical species which are present in the system, and number of chemical components is the minimum number of all those chemical constituents or chemical species which are required, whose amount fraction is required to be specified in order to specify the composition of each and every component in each and every phase completely. So, that is why from total number of constituents which are present, you have to subtract the number of equations available in terms of number of reactions, in terms of number of additional satisfying conditions being present. So, thumb rule is, if there is some chemical reaction which occurs in the system, if there is some additional satisfying condition in terms of stoichiometry or in terms of electroneutrality is present, then the number of components is less than number of constituents being present in the system. That is the thumb rule. So, I think with this discussion, the differentiation between number of components and constituents would have been more clarified. Now, having said this, let us take another very important example. Now, let us say that in that decomposition of ammonia, we had assumed that we had not added ammonia or hydrogen or nitrogen. We had added ammonia, but no nitrogen or hydrogen we had added. That is, these chemical species come from dissociation of ammonia only. But now, if we suppose that no, we try to add some arbitrary amount of nitrogen in the system, or if we say arbitrary means we do not know how much we have added. Some arbitrary amount of nitrogen or hydrogen is being added in the system, then the number of moles of hydrogen which would be present in the system would not be equal to 3 times number of mole of nitrogen. Then in that situation, this additional satisfying condition would not be there. This is no additional satisfying condition. So, in that situation, let us see, again the number of constituents will be 3. That is, that which are the constituents? Ammonia, nitrogen and hydrogen, and there is one equilibrium reaction between the 3 chemical constituents. So, R is equal to 1, but because you have added some arbitrary amount of nitrogen or hydrogen in the system, so Z which was there, Z which has been 1 earlier, now is 0. So, C, independent number of constituents equal to total number of constituents C minus R minus Z, and C, equal to 3 minus R, 3 minus 1 because R is 1, and is equal to 2. This is 2 here because additional satisfying condition does not exist. So, therefore, you are required to specify the number of moles of amount, the amount fraction of two of the chemical species, then only you will get the amount fraction of third automatically. Right. We can also consider here in an ionic solution of sodium chloride. Aqueous solution of sodium chloride is one chemical species and water is just another chemical species. So, without looking for such equations, we can easily say sodium chloride, by our knowledge, we know sodium chloride does not react with water. That is, it does not split the water, although there may be hydration of sodium ion chloride ion occurs and it lead to complete ionization of sodium chloride and it exists as sodium ion and aquated sodium ion and aquated chloride ion. So, since this is salt water system, no reaction occurs. So, number of constituent equal to number of components. So, number of component is 2. From this this number, we can also decide over here. By considering that there is no sodium chloride being present in the system, now you have whatever sodium chloride you have added, that is ionized and it is present in the form of sodium ion and aquated sodium ion and aquated chloride ion. So, now for every 1 mole of sodium chloride being added to water, there occurs, because by way of ionization, 1 mole of sodium ion is present and 1 mole of chloride ion is present. So, therefore, number of moles of sodium ion is equal to number of mole of chloride ion. When you divide this equation by total number of moles, what you get? Amount fraction sodium ion equal to is equal to amount fraction chloride ion. That is what you get. So, this is another additional satisfying condition. So, now here, how many in the salt water system when sodium chloride is dissolved in water, now see how many total number of constituents present? Water, sodium ion, chloride ion, So, three chemical constituents which are present, but there is no equilibrium reaction between them, because whatever sodium chloride you have added, it has completely ionized. There is no equilibrium, sodium chloride will not exist there. So, therefore, number of additional satisfying condition is 1, because number of moles of or amount fraction of sodium ion is equal to amount fraction of chloride ion, and both these chemical species are present in same phase. So, Z is 1. So, here CIND, independent number of chemical constituents or number of components equal to total number of constituents, which is 3 minus number of additional satisfying condition, which is 1, equal to 2. What it does mean? 2 in the number of components 2 means that you need to specify the amount fraction of water, you need to specify the amount fraction of sodium ions, then the amount fraction of chloride ion will automatically be there, because additional satisfying condition predicts that whatever is the amount fraction of sodium ions is equal to the amount fraction of chloride ion. So, you need not specify the amount fraction of chloride ion, it is automatically gets fixed. Once you say amount fraction of water is this, a particular value, and amount fraction of sodium ion is another particular value, then because amount fraction of chloride ion is equal to amount fraction of sodium ion, you need not give its value by your own. You need only the two terms. So, number of independent chemical constituents out of the three is 2, because only 2 are related, not all 3 are related. When all 3 would have been related, then number of independent chemical constituents would have been 1, like earlier. Right. Consider the liquid water system now. Now, we would see if we, it means in from the sodium chloride salt water system, we have already seen that either we consider ionization of sodium chloride or we do not consider its ionization. The number of components or the independent number of constituent remain the same. This fact can further be illustrated with the help of the example. This example is the water system. If suppose we have in the system only liquid water. So, liquid water, there is only one phase liquid phase in system. So, number of phases equal to number of phase equal to 1. So, P equal to 1. Now, there is only one constituent, water. So, C equal to 1. So, there is one constituent, it is not undergoing any decomposition or any other reaction. So, there is just one independent constituent, just specify its composition, that is it. So, therefore, the fact is, now if we consider that this water do ionize, if we consider now that this water do ionize in the system, so therefore, we can say that let us say water gets ionized. So, now the water is still present in liquid phase, there is total number of phases is still 1. But now the question arises, how many constituents being present in the system? There are 3 chemical constituents which are present now, if you consider ionization of water, that is water in as neutral species H2O and aquated H plus ions, that is H plus aqueous, one chemical species, and hydroxyl ions aqueous, that is one chemical species. So, 3 chemical constituents or species you can say which are present in the system. So, C is equal to 3. Now, the question arises, how many CIND or how many number of components? We have already seen when we do not consider its ionization, the C is just 1, CIND is also 1, that is the number of components and constituents is just been the same. Now, if we consider the ionization of that is equilibrium between water in neutral species as neutral species and hydronium ion and OH negative ions, if an equilibrium is considered, now let us see whether the number of components is different from number of constituents or not. So, although the number of constituents are 3, but because there occurs, you have considered one equilibrium chemical reaction, that is ionization of water. So, number of reaction is equal to 1, because there is this kind of condition exist, that is chemical potential of water equal to chemical potential of H plus ions plus chemical potential of hydroxyl ions. because stoichiometric coefficient of all of these chemical species is 1. So, this is just one condition in terms of number of reactions. So, R is equal to 1. And further, there is Z also. Due to, because of ionization of water, for one mole of H plus ion, there is 1 mole of hydroxyl ion. So, amount fraction of OH negative is equal to amount fraction of H plus ions. So, amount fraction of H plus ions equal to amount fraction of OH negative ions. So, this one additional satisfying condition. So, R1, Z1. So, number of constituent although is 3, R is 1, Z is 1. So, therefore, independent number of chemical constituents is still 1. So, what I want to convey to you is that if you consider a chemical species as its ionized state in its ionized state, or if it is present just as its neutral state, the number of components or independent chemical constituents just remain the same. This results from the fact that because of ionization being considered, two chemical constituents have been increased, that is H plus ions and hydroxyl ions. But with this consideration, with this, the number of reaction, the condition in term of equilibrium chemical reaction as one equation becomes available, and also another equation is available in terms of additional satisfying condition, that is the stoichiometry condition or electron neutrality condition. So the number of variables although rises by 2 when you consider ionization of water, then the number of equation also rises by 2. So, the idea is that it is immaterial, it does not matter whether you consider ionization of a particular chemical species or not, the number of independent chemical constituents just remain the same. Now, let us consider another example, that is decomposition of calcium carbonate. If suppose you have solid calcium carbonate in the system, and when you decompose it in vacuum, then what you get is there is equilibrium which is established between 3 chemical constituents, 1 calcium carbonate, 1 calcium oxide and 1 carbon dioxide gas. These are 3 different chemical constituents. Although you have added only 1 calcium carbonate, but because of decomposition of calcium carbonate and because equilibrium is established between the products and the calcium carbonate reactant species, what occurs is that you have 3 chemical constituents in the system. And it is important to note that because all the solids are considered, all the different chemical species which are present in solid state, each such solid is considered as different phase. So, calcium carbonate is one constituent present as one separate phase. Calcium oxide is one solid, is also present as another phase. So, 2 phases in terms of these 2 constituents, and third constituent carbon dioxide is also present as separate phase in terms of gas phase. And now, so therefore, there are 3 constituents which are present. Now, the point is that how many of these constituents are independent? That is the question. So, the answer to this question is that you should look for how many such equations are available in terms of number of reactions, in terms of additional satisfying conditions. So, there is one equilibrium chemical reaction, and in terms of reaction equilibrium condition, that is stoichiometric coefficient times the chemical potential of participating chemical species in the product side equal to reactant side, that is 2 times chemical potential of calcium carbonate, this 2 should not be there. This is by mistake has been written over here. So, it may be noted over here that this chemical potential of calcium carbonate equal to chemical potential of calcium oxide and sum of chemical potential of carbon dioxide to the right side. So, this is one equation. This occurs because there is one chemical reaction. So, you have R equal to 1. Now, in the same way as you had predicted for nitrogen and hydrogen which emerged from ammonia, decomposition of ammonia, here also you get from decomposition of calcium carbonate, you get calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. But because they are not present in same phase, because of their difference in amounts, in extensive amounts, there will not be a change in amount fractions because they are present in different phase. So, amount fraction of calcium oxide in one solid phase will always be 1. Similarly, amount fraction of carbon dioxide, because it is only one constituent being present in gas phase, its amount fraction will also remain 1 in the gas phase. So, now here, because of their variation in number of moles of calcium oxide or carbon dioxide, it will not lead to a change in amount fractions of calcium oxide and carbon dioxide, because they are always 1, so they are just one constant value. So, therefore, this equation does not occur, which says that amount fraction of carbon dioxide equal to amount fraction of calcium oxide. Because this equation would be applicable if calcium oxide, carbon dioxide and calcium oxide, if they are both are present in same phase, then only this equation is applicable. So, therefore, because calcium oxide is present in solid phase, carbon dioxide is present in gas phase, and both these chemical constituents are only constituents being present in these two phases. So, their amount fraction will always remain same. Even if you add some calcium oxide in solid phase or if you add some carbon dioxide in gas phase in the system. So, therefore, there is no this kind of additional satisfying condition is considered there. So, therefore, now you have C equal to 3, number of constituent equal to 3, that is calcium carbonate, carbon dioxide and calcium oxide. And there is one equilibrium chemical reaction, so R is equal to 1. And number of additional satisfying conditions is 0. 0 over here we have just explained. So, independent number of chemical constituents, number of component is equal to total number of constituents minus R minus Z. R is 1, but Z is not there. So, not here. Z is 0 there, which is being predicted. So, what you have is the number of components as 2. What it does mean? It does mean that the amount fractions of the participating chemical species calcium carbonate, carbon dioxide and calcium oxide by way of equilibrium chemical reaction conditions. But there is no additional satisfying conditions. So, there is one relationship between amount fractions of these three chemical species. So, you need to specify amount fraction of two chemical species so that you get the amount fraction of third automatically by way of relationship in terms of chemical equilibrium reaction condition. So, that is why the independent number of constituents or components is 2, that is the number of chemical species for which you are required to specify the value of amount fractions in different phases in which they are present. So, here it is 2. In ammonia decomposition, because nitrogen and hydrogen both were present in same phase, there was one additional satisfying condition in terms of amount fractions. So, there it became little easier, we could have only specified amount fraction of nitrogen, the other two would have automatically would have got fixed. Having said this, we can take another example over here, that is of if we have in a solution, aqueous solution, in which sodium ions, potassium ions and chloride ions and water is present. Now, we can consider from where these ions would have come. These ions would have come only when sodium chloride would have been dissolved, potassium chloride is being dissolved. So, therefore, when we dissolve sodium chloride and potassium chloride, it leads to sodium ions and chloride ions. And when potassium chloride is dissolved, potassium ions and chloride ions are furnished in the liquid phase. So, number of moles of sodium ions and number of moles of potassium ions is equal to number of moles of chloride ions. This is condition of electronutility. You divide this equation by total number of mole, you get one additional satisfying condition because all these chemical species are present in same phase. So, amount fraction of sodium ion, sum of amount fraction of sodium ion, potassium ion equal to amount fraction of chloride ion. So, you have one additional satisfying condition. So, here there are 4 chemical constituents, no reaction, one additional satisfying condition. So, 3 constituents which are being present. So, which you can say 2 salt, 1 water, whose amount fraction you are required to specify. Thank you so much. We will have more discussion on the phase rule and the phase diagram systems. Thank you so much.
With this note, thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. Dear friends, you can post your feedback at info.cc@nic.in. We would be meeting again very soon and would be carrying another session on Face Equilibria. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.